feast of the exaltation of your holy cross. May its sign always be visible before our eyes to strengthen us, that we may walk with you toward death, and then stand at your right hand to celebrate the feast of your eternal victory. We glorify you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, forever.
Power of God.
Hallelujah.
done to the glory of God and for the most of the Trinity. We grant this in the saints. Kyrie eleison. Before the proclamation of the Gospel of our Savior announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew, who proclaimed life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls. The Lord Jesus says, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. The foolish ones, when taking their lamps, brought no oil with them, but the wise brought flasks of oil with their lamps. Since the bridegroom was long delayed, they all became drowsy, and they fell asleep. At midnight there was a cry, 'Behold the bridegroom, come out to meet him.' Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish ones said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise ones replied, 'No, for there may not be enough for both you and us. Go instead to the merchants and buy some for yourselves.' When they went off to buy it, the bridegroom arrived, and those who were ready went in to the wedding feast with him. Then the doors were locked. Afterwards, the other bridesmaids came, and they said, 'Lord, Lord, open the door for us.' And he said in reply, 'Amen, I say to you, I do not know you. Therefore, remain vigilant, for you know neither the day nor the hour.' This is the truth. Peace be with you. Especially when we are children at home. What we see in this centennial of Fatima is precisely a mother's love, as dramatic as it is. When we have a child, we learn that who learns how to ride their bike, at some point the training wheels come off, and the parent has to let it go, even though we know they're going to probably spin out into the gravel of the playground. It's inevitable. So there are moments in our lives in which our parents necessarily have to allow us to kind of hit the ground. Because in order to help pick us back up, we learn, and we learn wisdom, and we make progress in life. Now, in some cases, when that's not done, then of course, these individuals, these children, never really grow up. And so there is always going to be this boundless love, but sometimes the love is translated in a way which may look painful, like letting go of the seat of the bicycle. We saw earlier in Fatima that in July, June, July, Our Lady gave vision to the 7-year-old, 9-year-old, and 10-year-old children. These children gave them a vision of hell, to see the damned, the demons and the damned souls pulsating with the fire that they compare to the coals which they would see in the fireplace. Pulsating with fire, these little children. And today, in October of 1917, in fact, quite literally on Friday the 13th this year, that year in 1917, it was a Monday. This year for the centennial, it arrives on Friday. But October 13th was the day that the Mother of God told the children from July onward, July, August, September, that there will be a miracle in October so that everyone will know that I am real and what I say is true. Now in the bulletin I've reprinted the request of Our Lady in July, because this miracle that happens on this day in 1917, there really is not much more of a message added to it. The request of prayer, of penance, of the daily rosary, of penance for the conversion of sinners. These requests are made months ago, and Our Lady, so to speak, allows everything to simmer over the summer, knowing that this is going to build up to the month of October. In World War I, what's taking place at the same time, just before October 13th, a few weeks before, you have the Battle of Passchendaele, which is one of the most horrific moments in World War I, comparable to something like Verdun, where you have tens of thousands of men who are killed in these horrible, bloodied, and muddied fields of Belgium. And that same rainstorm, that same meteorological event, is also what causes it to rain continually in Fatima. And yet, for days in advance before the 13th of October, tens of thousands of people converged upon this cove. The estimates from the eyewitnesses is that there were 70,000 people present. So picture to yourself a football stadium of the number of people who have arrived here from all over Portugal and beyond, who have come because there has been a promise of a miracle to be seen publicly. As I mentioned to you before about the mother's love, in the Martel family, the brother and sister, Francisco and Jacinta, their parents believed that they saw something. They didn't make an act of faith in all the details, but they knew that their children were not liars. On the other hand, with Lucia, her parents never believed this. In fact, her mother, like I mentioned to you before, she had a difficult home life. Her father was basically what we call an alcoholic now, and he gambled. The family was always on the verge of losing not only their lands, but the food, simply. During the whole Fatima events over the summertime, July and August, September, parts of the land where Fatima, where the apparitions were taking place, belonged to her family. And so the crops they had planted were all trodden down. And the family that summer actually came close to starvation because they didn't have the means to feed themselves. And in the midst of all that, Maria Rosa, the mother of Lucia, never believed her daughter. In fact, she hammered upon the 10-year-old continually, "You have got to stop making this up. You have got to stop telling stories." And Lucia keeps repeating that they are not stories, they are things which I have been told. And so when October comes, Mr. Marto takes his children to be there in the midst of this enormous crowd. And Maria Rosa goes along with her daughter, having up to the last minute told her, "You have to renounce this. because she doesn't believe anything is going to happen in October, and she is terrified that a crowd which is there expecting something and having nothing happen will turn into a mob and will descend upon her daughter and do God knows what kind of damage to her. And so they all arrive, and it's raining, and they're on umbrellas. You have pictures of the day. Photographers were there. Newspapers reported this event, as Masonic and as anti-Catholic as the government was at the time. And of course, what's taking place simultaneously at this moment is 2 days before this, October 13th, 2 days before this, Lenin in the north makes his decision that now is the time for the Bolshevik Revolution. It's going to happen on November 6th. The entire history of the world that we live now is rooted in all of the events that are taking place in World War I and before, but it's really very clearly in World War I. And so when they all arrive and it's raining, it comes to about midday when the apparitions happen. And what takes place here in the rain is nothing happens. And there is a great fear. In fact, some of the priests who are there, one of the priests who's near Lucia, just simply says this is all a lie and starts to try to push the children to believe. The children don't move. As we mentioned, what is the extent of a mother's love? It has both its punishment aspect, its clarity, and of course its nurturing charm and staying at the side of the sick bed. In the Gospel of today, we have the problem of these bridesmaids is they all do the same thing, except that some of them don't provide for the future. They lack prudence. They lack wisdom. They're certainly all dressed for the wedding. They certainly all become tired, and they all fall asleep. What distinguishes them between wise and foolish is that the foolish have not looked towards the future. So what takes place in Fatima on October 13th, 1917 is certainly for the people who are there. But it is more importantly for the generations to come in the future. As I mentioned to you, I believe that at the centennial in 2017, we are only halfway through the message of what Fatima is really telling us. The same way with the apparitions of the Sacred Heart in the 17th century. France, those apparitions don't come into full blossom, as it were, until the 19th century. About 6 or 7 generations to work through this. At noon, if it's raining, Lucia all of a sudden tells everyone, put down your umbrellas. And as the word goes out, the umbrellas all start closing down, but it's still raining. It's kind of nuts. And then, as Lucia is kneeling there, everyone's been saying the rosary, she sees the flash from the east. And she tells Lucia, she tells Jacinta and Francisco, Our Lady is coming. And as it has happened in all of them, coming from the east, this light, the children see this light arrive, and in this overwhelming light, they see the form of the Mother of God. And we are told by the witnesses around them that the children's faces flush, but become transcendent in beauty as they kneel there looking at what nobody else sees. And the first question that Lucia says to her is, what do you wish from me? This is the foundation of the entire spiritual life. What does God want from me? What does he intend me to do in my life, personally? Not the theory in the catechism book, but of me individually and how I will live that life of grace. And when Our Lady answers Lucia, she says to her, have them build a chapel here in my honor. And let them continue to say the rosary every day. That's the only request which has been stated every single month. Take 15 minutes, 20 minutes a day, and say the rosary. Then she tells them the war is going to end. Of course, we're coming towards the end of 1917. And the soldiers will return home soon. She then says, I am the Lady of the Rosary. At that point, Lucia says, there are many people here who are sick or who are praying for people back home. Will they be healed? And Our Lady says to Lucia, some of them will be, and others no. But all must ask pardon for their sins. And sinners must cease to offend the Lord our God, for he is already very much offended. And at that point, she opens her hands, and this light, the children say, the light passes from her hands up to the zenith, to the highest point, in the midst of this cloudy, rainy sky, a gray day. And when the children look up, Lucia tells, she says, look at the sun. And the people, of course, only the ones around her first hear this, and it has to all reverberate out. And as they all start looking up, the clouds begin to part, and what the people see is the sun, but the sun in a form that they've never seen it before. It's kind of a silvery blue, but you can look at it. You're not blinded by it. But there are now two things which take place in this apparition. One which is seen by the children, and the other which is seen by the public. For the children, what the children see first and foremost is a tableau of the Holy Family. They see Our Lady in the classic look with the blue robe, and they see St. Joseph holding the Christ child. In September, they were told that St. Joseph would come to bless the world. And what the children then see is St. Joseph making the sign of the cross three times over the crowds. And the Christ child does likewise. Then Lucia continues to see what eventually becomes the mysteries of the Rosary, the joyous, the sorrowful, and the glorious. Because it shifts from the Holy Family to the sorrowful mysteries, and what the children see them, what Lucia sees, is Our Lady of Sorrows and Our Lord in the way of the cross, the fourth station of the cross where Our Lady meets her Son during his path towards crucifixion. That's what she next sees in this apparition. And then thirdly, it transforms to Our Lady of Mount Carmel for the glorious mysteries, crowned and in glory with the Christ child standing on her knee. So the three mysteries of the Rosary are done during this time. And this whole apparition lasts about 10 minutes. And what everyone else sees, the public miracle, because the people don't see those tableaus of the mysteries of the Rosary, what the people see is the sun. They're all staring at this silvery blue disc, which then begins to move. The people use the term dance. The sun begins to dance, it moves, and then it stops and it begins to spin, whirls. And as it whirls, it starts shooting off streamers of light, first in blood red. And they talk about how in the crowd, the red was reflected everywhere, throughout the field, upon the people, on their clothing. Everything turns red by this, as this thing begins to start spinning. And then the color changes to orange, and to blue, and to green. It changes to the different colors, ultimately of the spectrum, as the people are all watching this in amazement. And it does this three times, and it stops, and it spins, and it throws off these streamers of light. And while everyone is amazed by this watching, it stops, and then it begins to zigzag down towards the crowd. At that point, everyone is in terror. This is the end of the world. They start running. You start having screaming. People are falling into the mud, sobbing. They're asking for mercy. And as it comes down, it stops again. And the same way they say it zigzagged, motion back up, returns into the middle of the clouds and is transformed back into the normal sun that you can't look at anymore, so everyone has to look down. And at that point, they realize among these crowds that the ground, that their clothes, are all dry at the end of this 10-minute period. Now, as we said, the newspapers cover this in the days that follow. Can't deny 70,000 people seeing something. And even this is seen from witnesses who are over 20 miles away, so it's not a part of being in the cove which was the effect. Something truly happened in that region for them to see. So on this miracle of Fatima, on this centennial, let us ask the Mother of God, our Mother, that she obtain for us a profound faith to know that she is real and that what she has asked for is true, and that she grant us the wisdom not only to see in our own personal lives, but to look towards the future, so that we ourselves will be amongst the wise bridesmaids who provide not only for the present moment, but who also foresee the future. And in following in these footsteps, may our Lord give us the grace and the strength to enter the kingdom of life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We believe in one God, the Father of all things,
maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe in the one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God.
Salvation for us. We recall upon this offering all those especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Chardin. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered, for the repose of Robert Sturdivant. Remember also all those who have shared with us today in this offering.
Exalt you in all creation.
glorifies you. Look upon your children and call out to you. With purity and holiness may we offer you an acceptable sacrifice, that we may raise glory to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O God, the Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion and dwelling of the Holy Spirit, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever. Substantial Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, a majesty that does not need our glory and become greater with our faith. O Lord, those who sing your praises are countless, and they cry out with angelic voices and sweet melodies, proclaiming, Sabe estar Do this in memory of me. Each time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you remember my death until I come again.
We remember your death, Lord. We profess your resurrection. We await your second coming. We implore your mercy and compassion. We ask for the forgiveness of sins, and may your mercy rest upon us.
O Word of God, who can comprehend that you willingly emptied yourself of your divine glory, who can explain your miraculous birth from a virgin, who can repay you for your saving passion which you freely endured, who can praise your plan of salvation for us, we can only ask of you, O Lord of all people, that this sacrifice which we have offered be accepted on your altar in heaven, the dwelling place of your hidden divinity in the company of all the angels and saints. Through this sacrifice may we be worthy of the forgiveness of our sins. When you come to judge the living and the dead, do not pass judgment upon us, nor deny us, saying, I do not know you. On that glorious and fearful day, do not separate us from you, nor cast us off from your paradise to a place of weeping and gnashing of teeth. Rather, because of your holy name, by which we have been called, look with mercy upon us. In your compassion you have made us worthy of the gift of your forgiving body and blood. So make us worthy to be one with you in holiness, as you are one with your Father. For this your church implores you, and through you and with you implores your Father, saying,
have mercy on us.
Receive your graces, we thank you for them, and because of them,
we praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we profess our faith in you, and we ask you, have compassion on us, O God, have mercy on us, and hear us.
Ave Maria. Nasrallah Peter, our retired patriarch, Gregory John, our bishop, the venerable priests, the chaste deacons, the pure subdeacons, and all the orders of the Church. Teach them the word of truth so that they may spread it faithfully. With justice and holiness, may they care for the flock that you have entrusted to them. Give them the proper means to accomplish your will and grant them a long life. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the dejected, for orphans and widows, for the sick and the distressed, and for those tempted by evil spirits, be the guardian and refuge of their lives. We pray to you, O Lord. Remember the holy fathers, the prophets, apostles, preachers, evangelists, martyrs, and confessors, especially the holy, glorious, and blessed ever Virgin Mary, Mother of God, St. John the Baptist, the messenger and forerunner, who witnessed the betrothal of your holy church to your Son, glorious St. Stephen, the archdeacon and first martyr, and all who pleased you and professed your holy name. We pray to you, hidden and seen, committed with or without full knowledge. Make us worthy of a faithful Christian death that is pleasing to you, and join us to your righteous ones and to those who have done your will, that in us and in all things your blessed name may be glorified. With the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever. Yes, O merciful Lord, we ask for your compassion. By your grace, make us worthy that your glorious name may be made holy in us. That your kingdom come to assist us in our weakness, and that your will dwell within us. Deliver us from all difficult temptations. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
Amen.
O Lord God, you are good and the lover of all people. Look upon those who bow their heads before your majesty and bless them with every spiritual blessing. Do not turn us away when we approach your divine and holy gifts, and let us not be guilty of unworthily receiving the body and blood of your only Son. Rather, make us worthy to share in your holy and life-giving mysteries with purity, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your good and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Amen.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity. One Holy Father,
one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God,
so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life.
Lord Jesus, you have made us worthy to share in your holy body and in the cup of salvation. How can we repay you for these your gifts and graces and for your goodness? As you have called us to approach this life-giving banquet, make us worthy, so that your body may be mingled with our bodies and your blood with our souls, for the pardon of faults and the forgiveness of sins, and for eternal life. You are blessed and your kingdom is holy, and we raise glory to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
O God the Father, we bow before you, and we entrust ourselves to your care. We ask you, imploring your mercy, to rest your right hand full of blessings upon us. Assist us, protect us, bless us, and sanctify us by the cross of your only Son. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
So as a last announcement, there is a box at the front of the church here that has envelopes and the raffle tickets at the beginning of the bazaar, so our annual fundraiser. So if you would please, before you leave, just check for the letter that's addressed to you. It will make FIFA have to put less stamps on tomorrow or on Tuesday for mailing them out. We appreciate your cooperation. And may this be a very successful bazaar this year. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.